Real quick before we get into today's video, just want to thank all the people over on Patreon for all their support, because without their help, the upgraded content that you see on the channel, that you really see in the video essays and a few of the lore discussions, would not be possible without their help. Obviously, the YouTube membership filler arc is still ongoing, but I can say over on the Patreon that you get sneak peeks of videos months in advance. Patrons also get priority on the Q&As. Every 3 months, we do an anime and manga haul, and I give away a lot of good goodies in that. And it's also just really cool to talk to you guys in the DMs, and if some of you guys have theories that you want me to talk about on the channel, obviously I will talk about your theories. Just send them to me over on the Patreon. But with that being said, let's get into the review.
Yo, what's going on, everybody? It's your boy Naruto Explain here, bringing you guys a review for Boruto episode 221. And now that episode 221 is done in the books, yes, obviously we have a lot to go over, but first and foremost, let's celebrate this huge milestone that the Boruto anime has. 221 episodes. So we have now officially gone one episode further than what Naruto Part 1 had. And this should be huge for a lot of you guys, because I've been getting comments for a while now, people saying they thought that the Boruto anime was going to end at 220 episodes because Naruto Part 1 had 220 episodes. And like I've been saying for over a year now, just because Naruto Part 1 had 220 episodes does not mean that Boruto Part 1 is going to have 220 episodes. Boruto is the third installment in anime format. It's doing its own thing. Do not be surprised if the Boruto anime goes for over 300 episodes. I'm just going to say that right now. But getting right into it though, this episode and the idea to have a new Chunin exams, now that I've seen the episode and I'm not just going off of the spoiler summaries that came out a few weeks ago, I have to say I'm very impressed with Naruto's decision to have a Chunin exams done here. And I like the strategic element that's added into this Chunin exams by having all of the individual ninja nations have their own Chunin exams instead of working together. So the reason why that is smart is because after this battle with Isshiki, the five Kage, they've been put on notice. Like, this is different than what happened with Momoshiki attack. When Momoshiki attack, all of the Kages, they were gathered, and the Kages were able to fight against Kinshiki, and there was no problem. Naruto and Sasuke were ultimately able to just bully fuse Momoshiki in the battle, despite them not being at full power. There was a sense of, we did it, because the Kages had spent years training in preparation for a threat that was deemed being beyond Kage. So for them, there was no sweat off their back. But the idea now that Isshiki has appeared, and that there was no time for them to prepare, Naruto's lost Kurama, Sasuke's lost the Rinnegan, they have code out there, they have another 10 tails to deal with, they know that there's a larger battle looming and that they can't just depend on the Kages, because this last time the Kage power of Naruto and Sasuke, the two strongest people alive, was barely enough to bring down Isshiki, and even then they had to rely on a little bit of help from the prior generation. And as a side note, that goes back to something I said well over a year ago, which is the fact that Isshiki Otsutsuki was used to represent the fact that there is a Sage of Eight Paths, shown by the fact that he's got that Dharma wheel and that there was a narrative implication. I got the idea wrong that he had eight separate abilities, but from a narrative perspective, the idea that Isshiki was viewed as a bigger threat than anything we've seen before, just based off of Asian teachings, all of that held up. A few of you guys at the time disagreed that Isshiki was being used to hype up the fact that there was a tier beyond the Six Paths realm. And what I like is that the anime not only showed this, but by having these beings that are going beyond Jigen in terms of power, and potentially even going beyond Isshiki in terms of power, is showing that this last generation that was afraid of Six Paths power and all those threats in that realm, the new generation has to do what Naruto said, which is surpass them, which goes back to Naruto allowing ninja tech in this Chunin exams. And it also goes back to the fact that Naruto is allowing Orochimaru to work on technology that can combat the Otsutsuki. Everything narratively is lining up. We are starting the transition phase of moving away from Naruto's generation
being what is going to protect this world from the threats that exist, to Boruto's generation being used to protect those threats. This Chunin exams is starting that process of paying off what Naruto told the other Kages when they openly doubted the effectiveness of this new generation. Naruto is staking his legacy as Hokage on believing they can level up these kids who are already prodigies to a level to surpass them. And he's staking the fact that science can be used to aid them to make that possible. A lot of you guys have asked me, what is the point of this Chunin exams? That is the point right there. To determine not only which shinobi inside of their villages are worthy of becoming Chunin, but also to find out which ones have that potential and ultimately begin the process of pushing those candidates in the methods laid out before this. So with that being said, I want to go further into the review now. I like how we're getting the opportunity to just basically skip the written exam. It's very short in this episode and really just get into the Forest of Death portion. And the way that the Forest of Death is operating here is a little bit different. So they're not being given a few days to go through the Forest of Death and make it to the Chunin Tower in there, but instead, the whole purpose of it is to just very quickly gauge their skill level by raising the stakes and putting a time limit on there, which is basically saying, hey, you got people inside of there that are gonna be Chunin, who are gonna be your injured teammates. You're going behind enemy lines. You're dealing with all these creatures on top of that. You're also gonna have Chunin level fighters inside the Forest of Death. You have 45 minutes to go in there, save the people who are injured, and get them out of the Forest of Death, but you will have battles that are gonna be encountered, and they're using this as a way to judge the decision-making by putting a ticking clock on it. This is a much different method than just saying you got 3 days to find the scrolls. And I think that this works, and it's actually more efficient just given the fact that this new generation is starting off so much more skilled than their parents' generation was. And given the nature of these exams, you don't need to spend as much time. This is a evaluation first and foremost to identify very thoroughly who has the sound judgment to become a Chunin as well as the skill set. And as a reminder, like I've said before, just winning your battles does not make you a Chunin. Winning the tournament does not make you a Chunin. There are going to be 5 people who are going to be picked, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the people who finish with the 5 best matches are going to be promoted. You can lose and still get promoted to Chunin. You can win the entire tournament and not be promoted because you can tell a lot about somebody based on the way that they're fighting in battle. And I thought that this episode did a good job of just highlighting the various characters out of this generation and seeing how they operate, where you see people like Tsubaki who have very quick judgment as well as quick skills, as well as the power to back it up. You have people like Dinky who are able to use technology and able to use their wits as a way to make up for their lack of physical power. Another thing that really stands out is the fact that while you do see quite a few members of this new generation who are more than capable and live up to the whole claim that this new generation has overflown with geniuses, you also see that there are members of Boruto's graduating class who absolutely have no business being Chunin, at least at this point in their ninja careers. So I thought that the episode did a good job of very quickly distinguishing who the cream of the crop was. And as the cliche says, the cream of the crop will always rise to the top. But you see people like Boruto and his team, how they're very easily clearing through everything. Boruto and Team 7, they're easy favorites just based on the fact that they've gone up against Car inner members. And the scaling for Boruto and Team 7 has been very consistent when you look at all of the information that we have, not just from the anime, but also the manga and the light novels. Because when you look at the anime during the graduation exam, Boruto and Sarada were by that point in time somewhat relative to each other, and Kakashi looks at Boruto's skill and says, wow, you're clearly well above Chunin. And right after that, you have them going up against somebody in Mirai Sarutobi, who is stated to be a genius by Shikamaru, is stated to have extremely high potential to the point where Naruto's made her one of the Hokage guards for himself as well as Kakashi. But the other thing on this is that Mirai had skill level that was very close to Jonin level in terms of skill, to the point where Shikamaru in the Shikamaru Shinden novel is very certain that Mirai can defeat Shojoji if push came to shove. And the reason why that's important is Boruto and Team 7, after Misuki shows up and gives them support, they're able to moderately take out Mirai in their battle to the point where they actually troll her at the end and they leave her hanging on the bridge. And that was your first sign right there that Boruto and Sarada were approaching those Jonin levels in skill. And when you get to the Boruto movie novelization, it's directly stated that Sarada and Boruto are already at a Jonin level in some of their capabilities. And so you see that very clear consistency there. And it kind of transitions over to the battle against Ao. Ao was a very talented shinobi from the Mist Village. He was part of their Anbu unit over there. He was regarded as being highly skilled. He's somebody who more than once fought against Shisui Uchiha. The anime showed you him running away from him in a battle, but according to the manga, they've mixed it up a few times. So you saw Boruto and Sarada go up against a stronger version of Ao, who's been enhanced by ninja tech. You've seen them go up against Car and a member. We've seen Boruto on Team 7 progressively getting stronger as the series has been unfolding, and they've been going up against Jonin plus level threats for a long time. And I like how what the anime does is they give you this rematch of Sarada and Mirai, and this time it's Sarada and Mirai fighting by themselves. There's no Team 7 backing up, and Sarada defeats her off screen. So I like how the anime is kind of tying together quite a few things to just show you the progress markers for a lot of these characters. And by extension, as we get into the final rounds and we see all the characters go up against the various members of not just Team 7, but also Inojin and Chocho, who were able to briefly battle against Deepa. Even though they got one shot, the fact is that seeing how they do against those characters who are stronger than them, or in some cases, seeing how much their training has improved them off screen, which is just a shonen power cliff, it gives you the opportunity to start the process of bringing some of these other characters up in the way that Naruto wants to see done. Which goes back to the narrative intent of these Chunin exams, which is to see which characters have those potential and which characters have put in the work. That way you can start the process of beefing them up. So going into these Chunin exams, Boruto's team was already a favorite. But I do like how we get the opportunity to see that Boruto has another gear in him that's going to very much benefit him going forward in this. And that's the fact that Boruto has the opportunity where that new Genin who shows up, who was part of the prior graduating class, who was doing missions in another country. At first, I thought that he was already a Chunin and he was somebody who was a plant meant to be a chaos agent in the Chunin exams. But what we find out is that when this kid gets injured after betraying Boruto, the Chunin that Boruto had rescued tells him, well, we can just go to the finish line if you want to. And Boruto, I think out of the goodness of his own heart, as well as the fact that he realized that this was probably a test, Boruto not only checks on the injured Genin, but he also patches him up, uses a shadow clone, puts him on his back, and he takes the injured Chunin that he has as well as the injured Genin, and he tries to get across the finish line but ends up getting there too late. And they make it very clear, if Boruto had listened to the Chunin and had left him behind, that he could have crossed the finish line on time. But Boruto shows one of the elements that Naruto wants out of his Chunin, which is somebody who doesn't abandon his comrades. So I like that they kind of put that little tidbit in there to, again, just show you that it does not matter if you win or if you lose. It matters what judgments you make in the heat of battle. And in closing, the thing that I will say that I did like about this whole episode being Forest of Death-centric is we get a really good opportunity to just see the different personalities and how each of the different characters in the episode were able to react. So my question to you guys is, just based off of this very small sample size of what you saw from Boruto's generation in the Forest of Death. Name me your five candidates of who you think are in the early front running to become Chunin. And I want to remind you, it's not just about power. Power does not mean that you're going to immediately get promoted to Chunin. There are other qualifications to become a Chunin. So I want you to keep that in the back of your mind as you name me your five candidates. But as always, guys, if you like anything I had to say, don't forget to comment, rate, subscribe, and share. Thank you so much for watching all the way to the end. Have an awesome day, guys.